mano una pistola al tuo bambino.
Hey guys, coming to you here from the Nintendo E3 press conference, which I'm waiting for to begin.
Io non sono abbandonato.
Good morning.
Good morning.
To all of you here in the Nokia Theater and to all of you watching online. For gamers, this is the best week of the year. You can just feel the buzz in the air. And as usual, that buzz begins with technology. After all, E3 is the land of touch screens and big screens, HD and 3D, button control, motion control, and no controller at all. The headlines just seem to spin on technology. But this morning, let me adjust that perspective just a little bit. Because technology is only a tool. The end product, the thing that does matter, is the experience. And the best experiences always come when technology and game design are perfectly matched. Here at E3, with thousands of people battling to see and try everything at once, considering the experience is the only real way to make sense of it all. And this year, we intend to show you how Nintendo, once again, is raising the bar in terms of game experience. Let's begin with details on an experience you've been waiting for.
Today, I will introduce the newest version of Zelda, made exclusively for Wii, The Legend of Zelda Skyward Sword. I think this game will be remembered as a key turning point in Zelda's long history. At E3 2004, I stood on stage holding this sword and this shield. Adventures in Hyrule would not be possible without this sword and shield, and the items used to solve puzzles, and the map system used to confirm your location. In one sense, the history of the Legend of Zelda series has been a history of refining the interface that makes using these complicated mechanics easy. For many years, I've been asking if there wasn't a way to create a Legend of Zelda game that would give you the freedom to use your sword and shield and items freely and naturally. The answer I've come to this time is this. The Wii Remote and Wii Motion Plus. When we were making Swordplay for Wii Sports Resort, I spoke with our team and I said, "This is it. Let's make the next Zelda with this." With a sword this light, you can move it around as you like. And while in Twilight Princess, you use the nunchuck to move Link, this time, you will use it to raise your shield. And Wii Motion Plus isn't used only for sword control, it also makes using items very natural. On the bottom here is the B button. You just press this button to choose your item. But you know, it's kind of hard to understand without seeing the game screen, isn't it? Oh, I know. Hey, Bill, are you on stage?
Yeah, right here.
Can you help me out here? So why don't you just explain the rest?
I'll do my best.
Good luck.
Thank you. Okay, so good morning, everyone. I'm here to show you Zelda. So the Wii Remote, you see with Wii Motion Plus, the Wii Remote becomes my sword, right? And I've got my nunchuck, and that's gonna be my shield. Oops, there we go. Oh, so I can swing kind of at any angle here. Oh, wait, this is strange. Ow! What's going on?
Bill, that's not right.
What?
You gotta hold the shield more like a shield.
Wait.
And the sword like this.
Ow!
You know what? I think I'll explain it myself.
I think that might be a good idea.
Bill, you just take care of English.
Okay.
Okay?
That I can do.
So, じゃあ日本語でやります。
これね、あの、具体的に説明するともそんなに難しくはない。
So, I'll explain it in detail, but it's really not that difficult.
本当にあの剣と盾を持ってるっていうイメージ。
Just imagine that you're holding a sword and a shield yourself.
で使うのはこのリモートの AB ボタン。
And all the buttons that you're going to use are going to be the AB button on the Wii Remote and the C and Z buttons on the nunchuck.
ほとんどのアクションですね。
Other than that, all the actions are going to be done using realistic motions.
でまずこうゼルダに大事なのは、
So what's important for a Zelda game is of course
剣ですね。
剣は右
手を振れば。
So if you just shake your right hand, the sword will come out.
ですね。
And you can swing at any angle. And if you press the Z button, you'll target in front of you. And you can see the sword following my movements one to one. You can swing top to bottom, up and down. Let's take a look at these mushrooms here.It's very simple.
さあ、敵が出てきましたよ。デクババが作成する。
Okay, here we see the Dekubaba is popping.
これはあの、口のある方向に切らないとダメなんですね。
だから、Now, you have to pay attention because the only way to defeat it is to cut it in the same direction that its mouth is open.
ダメですね。
See? It doesn't work if you cut top to bottom.
ビルの方が上手かな。
Maybe Bill's a little bit better at this than I am.
横に
切ります。Okay, so here, I have to cut vertically.
Woo!
Oh.
そしてこの剣を高くかざすと、
Now when you hold your sword straight up towards the sky, you can see it charge up with the power from the heavens.
剣ビームですね。
And then you can let loose sword beams.
回転切りは両手を振ります。
You can also do attacks by swinging both hands together in the same direction. So I'm going to run ahead here. Okay. There's something over here, I see. What's this? There's an eyeball on that door. That looks kind of... Oh, look at that. Oh, if I try to cut it, it closes the eye. But it's looking at the tip of my sword.Maybe I can confuse it. There we go.
こんな感じで台本に入ります。
It's kind of silly, but fun.
さあ、ここから本番ですよ、ユ
ー。Okay, now the real fight begins.
今度は盾を使います。
Okay, this time I'm going to use the shield.
盾は右手を振ります。
So with the left hand, I'll give a quick shake to raise my shield.
オクタロックが出てきました、
ね。You can see an Octarock has popped up here.
盾を構えてるので。
I can use my shield to block his rocks.
じゃあこれを盾アタックで跳ね返します。
And if I do a shield bash, then I can knock the rocks back at him.
あれ
Uh-oh.
あれ
There we go.
こんな感じですね。もう一個行きましょう。
Oh, we've got one more here.
よし。あれあれもう一個。
Let me try again. There we go.
こんな感じですね。
See?
大丈夫でしょうか。これで木も切りますよ。
You can of course cut the grass as well as trees too.
縦に切っときましょうか。あ、切れましたね。
おっ、カルチャー。
まずレバーで。これはね、
Now, if you look at the Bokoblins, you'll notice that they're protecting themselves from their swords. They're trying to block my attacks. So I have to swing my sword in a way that gets around their blades.
Oh.
You know what? Maybe I think I should take a break and have a little potion here. That tastes good. Okay. It took a little bit more than I expected, but Now, when you're in battle, let me explain actually the A button here. When you're in battle, in targeting, you can use the A button to jump. When you're not in battle, you can run. You hold the A button down to run around and shake the nunchuck to roll. And then you can also run up cliffs and walls a little bit like this. So now let me go into the different items. Up until now, with the Zelda game, typically what we've done is assigned an item to a specific button. For this game, just imagine that all of your items are somewhere in a pocket. To put your hand in the pocket, you hold down the B button. And then you just kind of move your hand around in the air, and you can pick any item that you want. So you can grab bombs, or you can grab a whip this time. We'll explain that in a moment. But we'll jump down here in the meantime and go through all the items one by one. So we'll start off with the slingshot. Now what's nice is that this time in Skyward Sword, you don't have to point at the screen to aim. You just move the Wii Remote in front of you, like you're moving a real slingshot, and that moves the cursor to aim. And then you tap the A button to shoot. These are some fast spiders. Okay. I'll just take this one out with my sword. There we go. So next we'll take out some bombs. The bombs have a variety of different ways you can use them. You can press the A button to set them on the ground. You can just tap the B button to... Let's try this again. So you tap the B button to take another one out. We'll take another one out. Raise the Wii Remote to throw it. There we go. And then you can also drop your hand and roll a bomb. And if you're good, you can put a little spin on it too. Okay, next we'll try the bow. Okay. So you, looks like we're having a little interference here. Somebody out there using a wireless. Anybody? Everything went really well in our rehearsals. You guys need to turn off all your wireless devices. There we go. Yeah, we're getting some serious interference here, so... Okay. So with the bow, what you do is you press the B button, you choose your item, and then you hold down the C button on the nunchuck. Oops. Oh, I'm sorry about this. There we go. So you face forward, you hold it back, pull back on the C button on the nunchuck. And then when you let go, it fires an arrow. But it looks like we're having some trouble with wireless interference. We'll try explaining one new item that we have here today. This is a beetle. So this is a beetle that you shoot, and you fly around, you just tilt the Wii remote to control it. And you can see that the scenery in the game this time is very beautiful. So you can also use the beetle to pick up items. Let's see, we'll run over here. I think there's something I can pick up this way. There we go, we'll try this one more time. Okay. Alright, we'll go on to the next item. So we'll give up on the beetle and change over to the whip. Okay, so next is the, as we mentioned earlier, there is a whip in the game. And with the whip, you can, it changes its movement depending on how you whip it out. You can whip out, grab items, pull them back, use to cut the grass. So we'll use the whip to kind of have a little fun with this guy over here. So you can see, I can't defeat him with the whip, but what I can do is very quickly and easily switch to my sword. So with the new Wii Motion Plus, it's very easy to switch quickly between items. Now here we also have these bat-like creatures, the keys. They're kind of pretty pesky, but with a quick flick of the wrist, with the whip, you can take them all down at once. So, I don't know if it's because of the wireless interference, but we did have a few technical difficulties, but I can assure you that when you play it on the show floor, you're going to see that everything plays very smoothly and very cleanly, and that the new item system is very streamlined and feels great. So I hope you'll all give it a try on the show floor, because it is here, and hopefully get a taste of what it feels like to adventure in Hyrule yourselves. It's like you've gone there and done all the things that Link has done yourself. Then one more important thing I need to talk about. So we've been working very hard on implementing these new ideas into the game. In development, it looks like it's going to take through the end of this year. So you can all look forward to playing The Legend of Zelda Skyward Sword next year. Thank you very much.
Just the top line of our E3 story today. There's a lot more to come. Our goal is to provide new experiences for everyone. For the moment, let's deal with what Mr. Miyamoto has said is the highest goal of game design. Entertainment that can cross culture and age and gender. Today, we want to first introduce you to titles that are squarely based on this goal of universal appeal. Let's start with the wide world of sports, where developers can choose between ultra-realism or over-the-top arcade fun. In the first case, the moves are real, the characters look real, and there are real-life stars on the packaging. We all know the names. Great franchises like Madden NFL and Pro Evolution Soccer and MLB 2K. On the other hand, some prefer the arcade style that began with NBA Jam. And in fact, you'll see a new exclusive version for Wii on the show floor. But over the years, one humble hero has taken us along to the hardwood and the clay court, to the fairway, the diamond, and the pitch. And this year, Mario the Sportsman stays true to his roots, but swings back into action in some venues where even he's never competed before. December in America, we set the all-time record for sales of any video game system of any kind in a single month. Others claim that all those casual Wii owners don't buy games. But somehow, more games have sold for Wii in the 43 months since launch than any other platform ever over the same launch period. Then, there's a recent NPD study showing that Wii owners actually play their systems more often than other owners. And at the same time, according to the research firm Ipsos, nearly as many people intend to buy a Wii in the next 6 months as the other two home platforms combined. Underlying all those false assumptions about Wii is a mistaken belief that many new Wii owners just play Wii Sports or Wii Fit for a while and then lose interest. But that simply isn't the case. The reason is the popularity of intermediate or bridge games that usher new players toward the world of gaming. Mario Kart does that. New Super Mario Bros. Wii does that. Mario Kart has sold more than 22 million copies, and New Super Mario Bros. Wii more than 14 million copies around the world. And now, we'd like to show you our next bridge title that moves consumers along their gaming journey. It begins with the more than 177 million Mii characters created around the world. and every one of them is invited to play. Let me introduce you to We Party.
We Party. An all-new party game for Wii that puts you in the middle of the action and redefines multiplayer fun for everyone. With 13 different party game modes, including Board Game Island, Balance Boat, and all-new house party games that put the party in your living room, where you'll interact with family and friends to interact with the game. 13 party games, over 70 different mini games, and all the needs you care to invite. Wii Party, coming this holiday.
Wii Party is yet another Nintendo game that will drive social interaction, and that phenomenon has worked for third parties as well. Last year, that was proved by the breakthrough dance hit, Just Dance. And this year, it's time to get up and get down again, only on Wii. News last year, a lot of you got jazzed in a different way, hearing about a more intense title, a new Golden Sun for Nintendo DS. It's now subtitled Dark Dawn. You haven't heard or seen a lot since then, so let's fix that right now. This holiday season. And while Golden Sun brings back a lot of golden memories for its legions of fans. To millions of other gamers, Golden has an entirely different meaning.
Who here would say that it's one of the greatest shooters of all time?
Everybody. Set the standards for all video games in the future.
It was the first game that I could play multiplayer for 4 hours straight.
For me, it was the original. I mean, that game, if you looked it up now, I'd be done playing.
Let's say that after 13 years of gaming innovation, a new GoldenEye game is coming up.
Words to live by.
Today who aren't old enough to understand the impact that GoldenEye had when it first hit the market. If you've never experienced it, get ready for a landmark gaming experience. On the other hand, if you do remember those multiplayer nights, there's only one thing I need to say. Activision's new GoldenEye, exclusive to Wii, arrives in stores this holiday. There's an entirely different kind of hero whose global reach has spanned 8 decades. A mouse named Mickey. Our parents grew up with him, we grew up with him, our kids and grandkids will grow up with Mickey Mouse. And now, this universally recognized and beloved character embarks on a new chapter to add to his legacy in a game exclusive to Wii. It's called Disney Epic Mickey, and it sets a new tone and a new direction for this world-renowned icon. Ladies and gentlemen, to give you all the details, please welcome Warren Spector, General Manager and Creative Director, Junction Point, and Adam Creighton, one of the producers of Disney Epic Disney.
Thanks, Reggie, and hello to all of you. Adam and I are here to give you a first look at Disney Epic Mickey, Junction Point and Disney Interactive Studios' upcoming Wii exclusive title for this holiday season. The game is set in a world honoring 80 years of Disney creativity, populated by forgotten, retired, rejected characters, movie locations, and theme park attractions from Disney's past. Welcome to Wasteland. It's a world both familiar and strange. A world as varied and memorable, we hope, as the real Disney lands and stories that inspired it. The land Adam's exploring today is called Ventureland. It's what we call a quest zone, where you talk to characters, learn about quests, buy tools and supplies. Here, for example, Adam is talking to Wasteland's version of Smee, learning what Mickey has to do to continue to make progress through the game, and also about an optional quest that he can do or not do later in the game. In Ventureland, in addition to Smee, you may recognize some other characters from the film Peter Pan, but a little changed, and some theme park locations, also a little different than you may remember, including the Swiss Family Robinson Treehouse and the Tiki Room. Some of the Disney inspirations can be hard to spot. The Wasteland is really full of forgotten stuff, but identifying it all is part of the fun. One thing is for sure, though. no one will have any trouble identifying our hero, Mickey Mouse. For decades, he's been one of the biggest movie stars in the world, a television celebrity. Constant presence at theme parks, friend and teacher to our kids. But for all the success he's achieved, it's always felt to me, at least, that he hasn't quite become the video game hero he deserves to be. If my team and I have our way, that is about to change. To take Mickey to new heights of video game success, we knew we couldn't just look back at Disney's history or Mickey's past triumphs. We had to allow Mickey to do things no other game character could do and offer players something they'd never seen before. Our key innovation lies in our core game mechanic, drawing and erasing, using Mickey's new ability to control the essence of his cartoon being, paint and paint thinner. Using paint and thinner the way Adam is here, players can erase characters, objects, walls, plants, even the ground. Or they can restore everything to beautiful painted glory. In other words, players can dynamically change the game world to save it. But how each player decides to change the world makes a difference. Or, as I like to put it, playstyle matters. How you change your world, how you interact with other characters, that changes how the world looks, of course, but also how characters treat you, what they tell you, what they don't tell you, and how each character's story ends. Do you solve problems by using the power of thinner to erase and remove obstacles? Or do you solve problems with the power of paint, the creative power? Do you use paint or cleverness to turn enemies into friends, or do you simply defeat them? Do you take time and use precious resources to solve everyone's individual problems, or do you focus exclusively on saving Wasteland from the enemies that would destroy it? These are just a few of the options available to players, each with its own rewards and its own costs. At the end of the day, we want each player to feel like he or she has crafted a unique experience based on the choices made and the consequences of those choices. I believe the play style matters concept is the hallmark of modern game design. And the combination of Mickey Mouse and Nintendo means we can take that idea to a larger audience than ever before. Now that you've had a taste of a quest zone, let's check out another kind of map. You see, there are three location types in Disney Epic Mickey, a game that combines the best of adventure, platform, and role-playing games. There are places called action zones, where you'll engage in missions that can affect the way your story unfolds and change the lives of the characters you interact with. You'll have to visit the Disney Interactive Studios booth or the Nintendo booth to learn more about those, about Mickey's missions. There's plenty more to see than we're showing here. For now, let's watch as Adam jumps into a movie screen to enter our third location type. What you're about to see is called a travel zone, and it takes Mickey from one part of the wasteland to another. These are side-scrolling adventures, I bet you could tell, directly inspired by beloved Disney cartoons and the classic console platforming games we all know and love. Here's one inspired by Steamboat Willie, the cartoon that introduced Mickey to the world. There are many more cartoons that appear in the actual game. In closing, let me just say how excited I am that Disney has allowed me to create a game featuring Mickey Mouse. It's the company's crown jewel. Not many people get the opportunity to work with a star of this magnitude, to be a part of an 80-year history of joy and laughter. With Disney Epic Mickey, we honor Disney's rich creative heritage, to be sure. But to be true to that heritage, we had to honor another aspect of Disney's history. Walt himself once said, "It's kind of fun to do the impossible." Innovation has been part of Disney's culture and Nintendo's from the start. To take Mickey to the top of the video game world, we had to find a balance of heritage and innovation worthy of Disney and Nintendo. I think we've done a pretty darn good job, but I invite you to see for yourself on the show floor. There are team members waiting there to show you more of the game. So show up, see how playstyle matters, experience paint and thinner for the very first time with our hero, Mickey Mouse. Thanks to everyone at Disney and Nintendo who made Disney Epic Mickey possible, and enjoy the show. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Warren and Adam. And by the way, if you want more insight on the thinking behind Disney Epic Mickey, you can find an exclusive interview with Warren conducted by our global president, Mr. Satoru Iwata, at e3.nintendo.com. Of course, keeping popular franchises fresh calls for a lot of imagination inside Nintendo as well. In 1992, Mr. Iwata worked with a young developer named Masahiro Sakurai. Since that time, Mr. Sakurai has become famous in the gaming world for creating such diverse franchises as Smash Brothers and Kirby. It would be hard to conjure up anything more soft and cuddly than Kirby. And yet somehow, he's managed to work his way into the hearts of a lot of hardened gamers. They know Kirby's got game. And he hasn't had a starring role in a Nintendo home console in 7 years. So we decided it was time for a return engagement. The questions were raised, should a new game be cut from the same cloth, stitched together from previous work? Should Kirby stick to his knitting? Or spin a yarn in a way that yarn has never been spun before? My friends, the answers are right here. Slated for release this fall. Less than a year ago, Dragon Quest IX from Square Enix debuted in Japan exclusively on Nintendo DS. It's become a phenomenon, selling 4.2 million copies there. This epic adventure, with you helping to decide its path, can make claims to being among the deepest and richest experiences ever launched on Nintendo DS. You could describe it just by the numbers. With 120 mini-quests and additional Wi-Fi mini-quests, over 300 monsters, over 900 items to customize your character, and an infinite number of randomly generated treasure maps. But that would be selling it short. What fueled the craze in Japan is the interaction between players. It practically begs for multiplayer action. Dragon Quest IX links you up with as many as three friends to quest together. And the social element doesn't end when you shut your DS. In tag mode, the game will independently seek out other nearby players, quietly adding new characters and new maps to your adventure. And when I say deep, let me add this. Chico, maybe the top Dragon Quest fan in our treehouse, has now logged more than 140 game hours. And she feels like she's just getting started. Gamers new to the franchise can get involved at their own pace, but watch out, you'll get sucked in too. Dragon Quest IX, exclusive to Nintendo DS, arrives here in the US in just 26 days. And then, on the last day of August, passionate players on Wii will experience a signature moment with an old friend. Nintendo and Team Ninja have also pushed the Metroid franchise down emotional corridors it's never traveled before. Samus returns when Metroid Other M for Wii arrives in stores on August 31st. As you know, Retro Studios in Texas has produced some great Metroid titles. But when they said they were ready for something new, we asked them to take one of the most treasured franchises in video game history and to make it magic again. If you listen, you can hear it coming. Thank you. this holiday. With the names we've talked about today, Donkey Kong and GoldenEye, Kirby and Metroid, you might find your game memories sliding into the past. But we're going to close today by throwing you in the other direction, far into the future of gaming. It was Super Mario 64 that first moved us into fully rendered game worlds. It was the Wii Remote that got us up off the couch and into a new world of game control. And today, as I mentioned at the outset, we're not just raising the bar, but we're making that bar extend far into the distance. 3D play on Nintendo 3DS is on the way. At CES this year, we started hearing a lot about 3D in your living room. And of course, an initial investment there is gonna run into the thousands. And then there's the fact that there's nothing to watch yet or play on big screen 3D. But maybe, most of all, it's the glasses. You know, man, those glasses. And make no mistake, that kind of fashion-forward statement doesn't come cheap. Don't be surprised to pay a hefty amount of money for those glasses. And that's for every person in the room. Nobody said it was going to be easy. Well, no one but Nintendo. In fact, we think there's a better way. A solution that lets you take 3D along with you wherever you go. With ample game content available the first day on the market. And maybe, best of all, no glasses.
It will show you full 3D graphics without the need for special glasses. As you know, Nintendo produced first video game, first 3D video game, 15 years ago. And since then, 3D has been a constant consideration in our hardware planning. What we searched for was a way to make 3D games a reality, a product for mass market. and Nintendo 3DS is our answer. Let me introduce you. Here on this part, we have installed a 3D depth slider to adjust the 3D effect. You can maximize it, or you can remove the 3D altogether, or you can choose any degree in between, simply by moving the slider. We have also given a lot of thought to the screen itself. Because Nintendo 3DS is a successor to Nintendo DS, it naturally comes with a touch panel. As we experimented, however, we realized that fingerprints and other smudges reduce the 3D impact, and so did the decreased transparency of the touchscreen itself. In other words, a touchscreen and 3D screen do not get along very well. Because of this, we decided to employ a touchscreen only on the bottom, just we did for Nintendo DS. And what makes the images so impactful is not just the 3D image, but the nature of the graphics. It's been 6 years since we launched Nintendo DS. So while we've now added 3D, we've also made improvement to the graphics capability of this hardware itself. Something tells me this alone might cause a lot of enthusiasm in the development community. Next, let's consider control. We've installed what we call the slide pad, designed for analog. We've also integrated both a motion sensor and a gyro sensor. I'm really hopeful that, just as with Nintendo DS and Wii, a number of new game ideas will be born to take advantage of these new control mechanisms. Of course, it has compatibility with Nintendo DSi. Nintendo 3DS has a camera too. But look here, there are not one, but two camera lenses on the outside. What this means is you can also take photos and view them in 3D. Nintendo 3DS is a mass market device that lets you take and enjoy 3D digital pictures. You may want to try out this function at our booth. And I want to mention one more aspect. Nintendo 3DS is also capable of displaying 3D Hollywood movies. We are not announcing any specific plans this week, but at our booth, you will find demonstrators showing you 3D movie trailers for releases from Disney, Warner Brothers, and DreamWorks. You can see DreamWorks, How to Train Your Dragon, Warner Brothers, Legend of the Guardians, and the Disney's Tangled, all playing in 3D on Nintendo 3DS. To our knowledge, this is the first time any such 3D content has been demonstrated without the need to wear glasses. However, in the end, gamers care most about games. You may remember an announcement we made in January 2009, establishing a joint venture called Project Sora. It was led by Mr. Sakurai. Today, I can announce that Project Sora was actually established for one reason: to create a game designed specifically for Nintendo 3DS. We felt such a project deserved to feature a character who is already familiar to many of you, especially if you've been playing games for a long time. What you'll notice is that when 3D effects are added to the game, the surprise it can offer is not limited to the characters themselves. In addition, there is a much better sense of the height, width, and the depth in your gaming worlds. And therefore, you have much better ability to navigate them. For example, in Kid Rickhouse, you can more easily judge the distance between yourself and the floating object. But it's not just the 3D graphics that make Nintendo 3DS unique. Communication can even occur during sleep mode, as Nintendo 3DS periodically searches for Wi-Fi access points or other Nintendo 3DS systems which are also ready to respond. It will then automatically communicate with them without you knowing it. You might remember, Nintendo's used a somewhat similar function, but in that case, communications were limited because if those owners started playing another game, the communication stopped. Nintendo 3DS works differently. The hardware itself supports automatic communication regardless of what software is being played. Nintendo 3DS can also communicate using the internet through Wi-Fi access point. Owners can navigate variable information without having to do anything proactively. Even when you are not near a Wi-Fi access point, you may discover that new stages, new quests, ghost data, and the new rankings have already been downloaded. And we will provide this kind of very unique communication service in a way that can be used by anyone, regardless of their technical knowledge or their gaming experience. And there is no need to pay a monthly fee. Now, let me conclude today by returning the topic of games. Before Nintendo DS and Wii were launched, the majority of people in our industry cannot believe that these unprecedented ideas from Nintendo would work. So, in those cases, it was our job to build an install base, first by developing and marketing own first-party software. Very fortunately, the situation is different this time. We at Nintendo have launched many hardware systems, but in this case, I feel we will enjoy our biggest launch support ever from third party. Of course, internally, we are developing several kinds of games. For example, Mr. Miyamoto is working on the 3D version of Nintendo's, and you are going to find it contains some new visitors. You will also discover several other Nintendo titles this week. But I'd like to spend more time introducing Nintendo 3DS software coming from third parties. Behind me, you see a partial list of companies who intend to publish software for Nintendo 3DS. I cannot name them all, but I do want to draw your attention to several of them. Activision and DJ Hero, Level 5, Square Enix, including Kingdom Hearts, THQ, Electronic Arts, including Madden, NFL, Tecmo Koei Games, Capcom and Resident Evil, Warner Brothers Games, Ubisoft with Assassin's Creed, Namco Bandai Games, and Konami with Metal Gear Solid. To all of you developers and publishers, I want you to know that I'm truly grateful for the support you are offering. Thank you very much. And to conclude my section today, I'd like to have some of these developers themselves describe their reaction and their experiences on Nintendo 3DS. Thank you for your attention, and please enjoy the show.
First impression, seeing the screen, can I use expletives in a Nintendo media briefing?
Brilliant. That was my first reaction.
I saw some object floating in the air and it actually made me want to pick it up, which I thought was really impressive for such a small handheld screen.
The new 3D screen will definitely have an impact on how we design games.
It gives people a whole new tool set to do all kinds of different things.
Metal Gear Solid というゲームをですね 3D で携帯するとどうなるかっていうのを今、実験をしてます。ジャングルなんですね。で、手前にものがあって奥にものがあってその奥にもっていう
Resident Evil のシリーズ、これは、完全オリジナルです。ゲームとしてそこに秘められた謎であったりとかですね、もっともっと探求してみたいっていう部分っていうのがきっと出てくると思うんですね。壁の奥に何があるんだろうとか、このタンスの奥に何があるんだろうみたいなことって意識させることができると思うんですね。
Having all three types of inputs at your disposal, touch screen, D-pad, and now the analog controller,
it allows us to have more precision in the controls of our character,
which opens up interesting combinations of gameplay.
So I'm really glad that Nintendo is trying to push their online connectivity. The ability to capture 3D content with the Nintendo 3DS's new camera is pretty awesome.
Nintendo 3DS がゲーム機としてじゃなくて、ツールとしてみんなに使われる可能性を秘めているのがすごく重要な機能じゃないかなと思います。
違う進化を多分これから遂げていくんだろうな、そういう可能性を感じてます。
What could not be cooler than that? Who would not want to be a part of that future?
Thank you, Mr. Iwata, and thanks as well to all of our development partners. When we began this morning, we promised something for everyone, from Zelda to Mario, Kirby to Donkey Kong, Mickey to Dragon Quest, Golden Sun to Golden Eye, and Metroid to Kid Icarus.I hope you found something you're looking forward to. But we also talked about new experiences, and we believe nothing at E3 will deliver on that like Nintendo 3DS. Something you thought you knew perfectly well will now be perfectly transformed. What's added literally is a new dimension.All of you watching this on e3.nintendo.com, please stay connected because we've got more news and additional content coming up momentarily that isn't available anywhere else. I wish we could all transport here to LA this week so that you could get your hands on Nintendo 3DS at our booth. And when you finally experience it, you'll understand.Unfortunately, there is no way to adequately represent the Nintendo 3DS experience on stage. So we decided to try and communicate it a very different way. Let's see how this works. Still not a perfect answer. In fact, we've spent a lot of time trying to convey the impact of Nintendo 3DS. But in the end, there's nothing like the real thing. So we asked ourselves, could there be a way to do that right now? And the answer is yes. We're going to let all of you here in the Nokia Theater travel to that third dimension, right here, and right now. And that kind of travel probably calls for a tour guide. So we want to take this opportunity to introduce you to the people who will accompany you, both at the show floor all week and right here in the Nokia Theater today. Our demonstrators are equipped with Nintendo 3DS devices that will show you how video game characters and video game environments appear in that new dimension. It's 3D right in your hands. So, for the moment, I ask you to please stay seated while they work their way out to you. Wow. The test drive on Nintendo 3DS will take place just on the other side of the camera riser behind you. The 3D sensation should be immediate. It requires nothing but the naked eye, no more glasses. And in order to give everyone the experience this morning, we're putting a time limit on your Nintendo 3DS time. What you'll be seeing is just the taste, but be assured, live gameplay will be available at the Nintendo booth all week long. Finally, also for those of you here on site, there's one other opportunity. Since everyone isn't going to be able to hold the Nintendo 3DS here at the same time, so we're importing another element of our Nintendo booth right here to the Nokia Theater. In front of you here, rising from the floor, are multiple gameplay stations to let you become the first people ever to put the playable The Legend of Zelda Skyward Sword through its paces. So, enjoy your gameplay. There's no rush. The shuttles that will bus you to the next event won't begin leaving until 11 o'clock. And for everyone, when this week is over, we trust that you'll agree that Nintendo has once again raised the bar. Thanks again, have a great week, enjoy Nintendo 3DS, and please enjoy E3.